Welcome to this topic, which focuses on the significance of cystic degeneration. The first, or one of the first impressions we get from discrete lesion, is the composition. We focus in this chapter on the cystic lesions and their categorization and importance in the differential diagnostic. First, some terminology. There are two basic features of a nodule. These are the composition and the echogenicity. The composition of a lesion refers to the lack or presence of cystic and solid portions. The echogenicity does to grayscale level of the solid part of an anatomical structure. By the way, these are not only those features that are first encountered when a nodule is detected during an ultrasound examination. These two properties are the basis for the decision on the further management of the patient. This topic, which discusses the composition, and the next topic, which focuses on the echogenicity, are related. One, some aspects of the composition are presented under the echogenicity chapter. This part of the course, like most others, consists of the following sections: the introductory video lecture and the manual, which are partly overlapping, partly complementary, focus on the theoretical foundations. The aim of the lectures is to delve into differential diagnostics. The basis of the whole course is the case studies and mainly the videos in them. For technical issues, you can always find the link in the main page of the subchapters. This gives basic help if you have any problems. The videos are high definition recordings, so we need to watch the images and videos as accurately as in a live study. And the final comment, the essence of ultrasound is the distinction between small differences in grayscale level. Therefore, it is highly advised to watch this video in a dark room. You can anytime pause or rewind the video if you will make notes or if the explanation was not clear. The main themes of the lecture are presented in the table. First, we will discuss the ultrasound presentation and subtypes of cystic lesions. Thereafter, we move to differential diagnostics, we discuss the influence of cystic degeneration on the grouping of nodules, the impact of cystic changes on the everyday diagnostic, and the prevalence of cystic nodules in common malignancies. First, the categorization of the cystic lesions. The first task when we see cystic areas within a discrete lesion is to judge the ratio between solid and cystic portions. As a rule, if the solid parts prevail, then the nodule should be classified as solid or dominantly solid, depending on the proportion of cystic content. If the cystic areas exceed that of the solid parts, then the lesion is a cystic one. Move to the third row. Most guidelines do not mention a very important consideration. A purely cystic lesion less than 1 cm in maximal diameter is a normal finding in a healthy thyroid. These lesions correspond to dilated macrofollicles, and the term nodule for such areas should be avoided. Otherwise, we create thyroid patients from almost every human being. So there are cystic areas and cystic nodules. The latter are divided according to the proportion of the cystic content. If it exceeds 90%, then most guidelines use the term cystic nodule, while if the cystic content is between 50 and 90%, they classify the nodule as predominantly cystic. Let's turn to the lowest row. The point of distinguishing between cystic and predominantly cystic nodules is that malignancy is very rare in the former. The three practically almost always benign forms are the pure, the almost pure cysts, and the spongiform type cysts. If a nodule is predominantly cystic, it is worth to make distinction whether the nodule is peripheral or central type. Most malignant cystic nodules belong to the peripheral subtype. Let's see some examples of the different subtypes. The left thyroid presents numerous tiny cystic areas, which are less than 1 cm in maximal diameter and do not show solid parts. These correspond to dilated macrofollicles. If we compare them with the nodule in the right images, the only difference is the size of the lesions. The right case proved to be a pure cyst because after the aspiration of the fluid, the lesion has completely disappeared. This table refers to the basic terminology. Although the left upper nodule shows tiny cystic areas, the sum of these areas is surely below 5%, therefore this nodule should be classified as a solid one. In the left lower case, the solid parts exceed that of cystic areas, however, the amount of the latter is above 10%. Therefore, this nodule should be considered as a predominantly solid nodule. In the right cases, the amount of fluid exceeds that of solid portions. In the right upper case, the cystic content is between 50 and 90%, therefore this is a predominantly cystic nodule, while the right lower image is an almost completely cystic nodule because the fluid content is higher than 90%. The distinction between a pure cyst and an almost completely cystic nodule is not always possible, and not all guidelines deal with this issue. While discussing the role of cystic degeneration in thyroids, we will immerse in the details. Only one consideration. A fully anechoic pattern is a very rare case. A non-anechoic portion is not equivalent with the solid part because it may represent either a fibrin clot or fluid with high protein content, left image, or a fibrotic bundle, right image. A spongiform pattern is not a rare finding, but it is a true spongiform-type cyst. We call a pattern spongiform if it contains small cystic chambers divided by fibrous septae and does not present solid portions. A spongiform nodule is classified differently in various guidelines. Some guidelines are content with the proportion of spongiform parts exceeding 50%, while, for example, the ETA speaks of a spongiform nodule if the entire lesion is composed of spongiform areas. The case on the left is by no means a spongiform nodule, as we see spongiform areas in a very small part of the lesion. Although small cystic chambers can be seen in most parts of the nodule, in contrast with the spongiform pattern, they are mixed with solid parts. In the right cases, the spongiform areas exceed 50% of the nodule, therefore these lesions can be classified as spongiform nodules in all but the European Thyroid Association guideline. The final distinction relies on the appearance of the solid portion within a mixed, predominantly cystic nodule. If the solid part can be followed all along the inner surface of the nodule, then the nodule should be classified as a central type lesion. We meet this subtype mostly in follicular adenomas. A peripheral subtype means that the solid part bulges or projects into the cystic cavity. The peripheral type is typical both of benign hyperplastic nodules and papillary carcinomas. Grouping of cystic nodules and lesions seems to be not a very difficult task. However, in the everyday practice we face with a problem. In most cystic nodules we perform aspiration and the presentation of the nodule frequently changes after the aspiration of the fluid. It can affect both the subtype of the nodule and the echogenicity of the solid part and even may have an impact on the borders of the nodule. So let's see two examples in which the categorization has changed after the aspiration. Both lesions seem to be pure cyst before aspiration. However, after the removal of the fluid, the solid part has appeared. Although the left case proved to be a papillary carcinoma, it must be emphasized that this is an extremely rare finding. The risk of malignancy in a completely or almost completely cystic nodule is almost zero, surely below 1%. Similarly to the left case, a solid area has appeared after the removal of the fluid in the right case. This phenomenon is explained by the compression of the fluid on the solid part. After releasing this compression, the solid part may appear or may become much larger than it was before aspiration. The second and more important problem relies on the echogenicity of the solid part in cystic nodules. It is well known that the cystic fluid amplifies the echo signal, Therefore, solid part dorsal to the fluid seems to be more echogenic than it is. In both cases, the solid part has become darker after the aspiration of the cystic content. In the left case, this change has no practical relevance because the solid part was hypoechoic even before the aspiration. On the other hand, the change in the echogenicity had a more important effect on the echogenicity and therefore the categorization of the nodule in the right case. The nodule would be classified as a benign or a low-risk lesion in all guidelines before the aspiration, while after the aspiration, all guidelines would group the nodule among the most suspicious category. The right case demonstrates another phenomenon as well. After the aspiration of the fluid, the borders can occasionally become irregular. The importance of this change is not known, but on our experience, borders that become irregular after aspiration are of much less significance than irregular margins in general. So, when to define or categorize a dominantly cystic nodule? It seems evident that the composition of the nodule should be defined before the aspiration. However, it is better to judge the echogenicity of the nodule after the aspiration. If we have to define the echogenicity before aspiration, we should consider those parts of the solid portion which is located ventral to the cystic fluid. In the next part of the topic, I will discuss two intranodular echogenic figures which are related to cystic degeneration. I do not want to read the table. You can pause the video until you read the description. Typical comet-tail artifacts are presented in these images. These colloid crystals are usually found in cystic part of benign nodules. These bright granules have a dorsal narrowing tail. However, the latter is lacking in almost half of the cases. While comet-tail artifacts have a very high specificity, it means that the presence of these figures significantly reduces the risk of malignancy, the distinction of these figures from microcalcifications is not infrequently impossible. If a punctate echogenic focus is found within the cystic part, the interpretation causes no problem. However, they might occur within solid parts. It may be an optical problem. We see a two-dimensional image, therefore a comet-tail artifact within a cystic lesion might be simply a projection to a solid part. More important is the fact that the cystic content may disappear either after the aspiration or spontaneously. In such cases, the colloid crystals remain and seem to be located within solid parenchyma. The differential diagnostics of intranodular echogenic figures is discussed in a distinct chapter of the course. The other intranodular echogenic figure is an optical artifact. This can be seen in the dorsal part of a cystic area and is caused by posterior back wall enhancement. This is an even more common finding than comet-tail artifact. Fortunately, this should not cause differential diagnostic problems because this artifact can be seen exclusively in the dorsal part of cystic areas. It means that after the removal of the fluid, these figures are no longer found. These figures vary in size and shape, they may be punctate or linear. If we are aware of the possibility of backwall cystic figures, we can avoid misinterpreting the granular form as microcalcification. These cases present backwall cystic figures of different size and shape. The common feature is that they are located dorsal to cystic areas. The latter may be very tiny, as in the event of the figure marked with yellow arrow. Occasionally, the origin of a hyperechogenic figure cannot be clearly determined. This issue has a very limited importance. The figure marked with yellow arrow might be a comet-tail artifact or a backwall cystic figure. In the left images, we can see punctate echogenic foci which are located not evidently within cystic fluid. The nodule has some backwall cystic figures in the form of lines which can be seen in the longitudinal scan in the lower image. 3 years later, the situation has changed. See the right images. The cystic part of the nodule has increased, while the punctate echogenic foci have disappeared. The most likely explanation for this is that the supersaturated solution in the previous study became more dilute and therefore the crystals dissolved. If we compare the lower images, we can see that the number and brightness of echogenic lines have increased at the follow-up. This is the consequence of the accumulation of the fluid. In this table, we compare the presentation of cometary artifact to that of microcalcification. In the left case, two colloid crystals with the typical tail are shown, while the right papillary cancer presents similarly bright granules. The more important difference is not the lack of the tail, but the location of the granules. In the left case, these are within fluid, in the right, within solid part. Again, left a benign, right a papillary cancer case. The former presents back wall figures, all related to ventral cystic areas. The microcalcifications in the right case are less bright and a bit elongated. The left images came from a benign lesion, while the right ones from a papillary cancer. At first sight, the left case is also suspicious of having microcalcifications. However, similarly bright lines are also present, and most echogenic figures are related to tiny ventral cystic areas. Although the right case proved to be a papillary cancer, the two brightest hyperechogenic granules are both related to ventral cystic areas. It means that knowing the final diagnosis, these figures are conceivably microcalcifications, but based on their ultrasound appearance, they correspond to back wall figures. The first example presents a multinodular goiter with multiple solid nodules showing cystic degeneration. These are dominantly solid nodules which show multiple echogenic lines and granules. These are partly related to ventral cystic areas. On enlargement, the presence of tiny cystic areas ventral to echogenic lines is more evident. These figures are caused by back wall posterior enhancement. The second example underlines the role of patient history. The hypoechoic nodule in the left lobe contains echogenic figures which are suspicious of microcalcifications. These are not clearly linked to ventral cystic areas. However, if we are aware of the previous situation, which is demonstrated by a video recorded 2 years earlier, these figures are no more suspicious. These echogenic figures have been already present for 2 years when a cystic nodule has been aspirated. These figures vary greatly in size and shape, but it is obvious that all of these figures are related to ventral cystic areas. It means that these are back wall figures caused by posterior enhancement. In this table, I present the results of Kim et co-workers. They have analyzed more than 200 surgically treated thyroid nodules. It is worth thoroughly analyzing the data. Those features which occurred significantly more frequently in benign lesions are highlighted with yellow, while those which were typical of a malignant nodule were highlighted with gray. Regarding the basic subtypes, concentric, which means central type, and spongiform cyst were found almost exclusively and exclusively in benign lesions. Peripheral type cysts, which are named as eccentric by the authors, were the typical presentation of cancers. The authors found no malignancy among nodules presenting cometary artifacts. It is worth to pause the video and thoroughly analyze the data. A piece of data is definitely worth highlighting from the table, and that applies to echogenicity. Almost half, 5 out of 11 cancers, occurred in isohyperechoic nodules. This ratio is significantly lower in dominantly solid nodules. This table summarizes the most important subtypes of cystic nodules. I gave their prevalence and the risk of cancer in the various subtypes. Again, you can pause or rewind the video in order to immerse into the data. In the next part of the presentation, the influence of cystic lesions on the thyroid's categorization is discussed. The different systems include different subtypes among the benign or the lowest suspicion subgroup. The common type in all classification is the pure cyst. By definition, this type of cystic nodule does not contain any solid parts. As it has been mentioned, pure cystic lesions less than 1 cm in diameter are better to consider as normal than pathological finding. The issue is that the five societies define in three different ways those cystic lesions which do not require diagnostic cytology, or in other words, in which we do not have to deal with the echogenicity of the solid part. The definition of the European Thyroid Association is the strictest because it includes not only the lack of solid part, but even the lack of any wall thickening. The American Thyroid Association and Korean thyroids are satisfied with the lack of solid part. The guideline of the AACE is the most permissive, which seems to be too permissive. The definition of the ACR is the only inaccurate one. Except for the American Thyroid Association, spongiform cysts are included in all but the ATA classification. First, it is worth to distinguish the spongiform appearance from the spongiform nodule. Spongiform appearance, also known as honeycomb or puff pastry, means an area which is composed of tiny cystic spaces separated by fibrous septa. This interpretation is uniform. On the other hand, there are differences in the use of spongiform nodule. First, some authors and the European Thyroid Association restrict this term for nodules which are entirely composed of spongiform areas. Others, including the three American societies and the Korean thyroids, define nodule as spongiform if the microcystic areas exceed 50% of the nodule. Moreover, the latter four thyroids differ in whether the echogenicity of the solid part is taken into account in the determination. While Korean and in part the AECE thyroids restrict the use of spongiform nodule only for isoechoic nodules, ACR and the ATA thyroids do not. As we have already learned, cometary artifacts is typical of a benign lesion. Three societies mention this figure in their main table. In the AACE classification, a nodule presenting cometary artifact can be grouped among the least suspicious group if the nodule presents no other suspicious signs. In fact, the presence of cometary artifact downgrades the nodule by one category. The Korean thyroids classifies all cystic nodules having cometary artifacts among the most benign lesions. Considering the high interobserver variation, this suggestion seems to be too permissive. There is a third society which takes into account cometary artifacts in the classification of nodule. The American College of Radiology introduced a new distinction. It speaks about small and large cometary artifacts. The distinction is based on the fact that cometary artifacts are not infrequently difficult to distinguish from microcalcification. Small cometary artifacts in solid part is worth 3 points in this system, similarly to the microcalcifications. Here I mentioned the first time, which must be emphasized in a postgraduate course. Thyroid systems became very popular, but there are several deep concerns about them. The first is a methodological one. None of the thyroids permit uncertain answers regarding ultrasound characteristics. This attitude of thyroids is seriously misleading, and it is in sharp contrast to the real-world situation, and essentially this approach could be very harmful. I present here the results of a recent study in which 7 highly experienced investigators reviewed the video record of 123 consecutively operated nodular goiter patients. One of the questions relied on the presence of uncertain hyperechoic spots. In almost half of the cases, these colleagues with at least 15 years practice with thyroid ultrasound have found echogenic figures which were non-classifiable. The huge range of yes answers is also thought-provoking. So an experienced examiner is aware that an ultrasound feature is very often not classified in one category or another. The experienced examiner knows this, while colleagues using the ultrasound findings and less experienced ultrasonographers need to be enlightened about this fact. Except for the above discussed subtypes, the classification of a cystic nodule has limited influence and no relevance in the two most suspicious subgroups. Yes, that's the appearance. However, the above mentioned different approaches of the guidelines have clinical consequences even for the suspicious subgroups. Let's see only one example. This is a seemingly cystic nodule. On Doral analysis, we can reveal a structure which is a tiny solid area. This is pointed with yellow and red arrows. Because of the presence of solid area, the lesion cannot be handled as a benign lesion in the European classification. And because the nodule shows taller than wide sign, diagnostic FNA should be performed if we follow the suggestions of the European Thyroid Association. In the American Thyroid Association classification system, the categorization of the nodule depends on the judgment of the echogenicity of the tiny solid portion. If it is judged as hypoechoic, then the ATA also classifies this lesion amongst the most suspicious category. If we judge the solid area isoechoic, then we cannot categorize the lesion in the American Thyroid Association thyroids, because the suggestion of the system is equivocal in isoechoic nodules presenting suspicious findings. But this is a later story. Now we turn to the influence of cystic degeneration on the everyday practice. The first topic has been already discussed. The presence of cystic degeneration has a deep impact on cytology. Because the cystic fluid is much easier to aspirate than the solid portion, this almost always dilutes the specimen. This can be observed even in the case when we directly aspirate the solid part, because the latter is usually soaked in the cystic fluid. Cystically degenerated cells vary in their appearance and are more difficult to judge. And last but not least, the fluid is an excellent substrate for proliferation of cells. Occasionally, a disturbingly cellular smear is prepared from cystic content. All of these conditions act in the direction that cystic degeneration impairs microscopic analysis. There is a distinct subgroup in the non-diagnostic Bethesda category. In the so-called cystic fluid-only category, the risk of malignancy is lower compared with other subtypes of non-diagnostic FNAs. The cystic fluid has a not negligible impact on the ultrasound presentation of the thyroid. The well-known optical rule, the amplification of the echo signal dorsal to the fluid, has already been mentioned. This makes the appearance of the dorsal solid part more echogenic, it is deceptively more calming than it is. Some of the mixed nodules are causing compression of the neighboring anatomical structures. The relief of the compression after the aspiration not infrequently makes the nodule borders irregular, lobulated. We only mention here the fact that cystic nodules can be treated very effectively with non-surgical methods, first of all with ethanol injection therapy. The cystic degeneration of two non-thyroidal elements has to be mentioned. Parathyroid cysts frequently seem to be pure cysts. If we aspirate a watery content, it proves the parathyroid origin of the lesion. The real anatomical location is frequently difficult to judge in a large parathyroid cyst before the aspiration. If we have suspicion that the cyst was parathyroid origin, we can indicate washout thyroglobulin and parathormone determination from the aspirated content. While cystic degeneration of a thyroid nodule decreases the risk of cancer, the situation is just the opposite in lymph nodes. The presence of cystic fluid within a lymph node is an alarming sign of metastasis of papillary cancer. Now we move to the discussion of cystic nodules in thyroid cancers. There are three important considerations. First, cystic component is found in around 1/5 of thyroid cancers. Most of the cystically degenerated carcinomas are not cystic nodules because the fluid content of them is less than 50%. Almost all malignancies belong to the papillary subtype in cystic lesions, and practically all cancers in dominantly cystic nodules are papillary cancers. The third consideration has been already mentioned. As a rule, the presence of cystic degeneration decreases the likelihood of malignancy, but except for special forms of cysts, this has limited practical relevance. So, papillary cancer is the subtype we should consider in cystic nodules. In the event of follicular cancer, I emphasize that cystic degeneration proved to be the strongest negative predictor in follicular tumors. This is a very important data neglected in the everyday practice if we take into account that we cannot differentiate the benign and malignant forms of follicular tumors. The ultrasound presentation of medullary cancer is very similar to that of papillary carcinoma. Beside microcalcifications, the other important difference is that in contrast with papillary cancers, cystic component is observed much less frequently in medullary cancers.